Corey, again, set the stage for us on what this new HP looks like.
Yeah, so I'm here in Palo Alto, right in the very town where the where Hewlett-Packard was created, the very first of the two guys in a garage startups in technology. Of course, Hewlett-Packard started the company all the way back in the late 1930s. And this company has struggled so mightily over the course of the last 20 years, really, returning to this idea of splitting itself, hoping that the sum of the parts might be indeed a stronger company. But one of the sort of secrets of this business is ever since the first laser jet was introduced back in 1982, this company's principal source of cash flow and profits has been selling printers, indeed selling ink and paper. Well, that's not the dominant form of profits for the company. It's still a very important part of this business. They're hoping by separating that business out, they could focus on the high revenue, if not as profitable business, of data storage and other things that the business they hope will grow a new Hewlett-Packard, leaving behind things in the past, things like computers, things like test and measurement, which they spun off an Agilent back in 1999. Meg Whitman really changing the goalposts ahead of the analyst day, where she has said all year long she's going to tell you how the company is going to be successful. She had to wait until that date in October. That date is later this week, now with a very different story to tell investors and indeed the entire community of Hewlett-Packard employees. We should mention also that the restructuring and layoff costs at Hewlett-Packard continue to spiral. They announced that they're also going to lay off as many as 55,000 workers in a round of layoffs that we thought was only going to be 10,000 initially. Finally, it's worth noting that Meg Whitman's pay package is a little bit richer when she has restructuring costs. Her bonus pay, a quarter of her bonus package, is a pre-restructuring cost. The bigger the layoffs, the bigger her bonus pool.
Indeed. And, you know, Corey, we've been saying, as you and I discussed with Leo Hendry in the last hour, that Meg Whitman had, you know, had talked for so long about not splitting the company, and now she is. So why hadn't shareholders really pushed her on this move? I mean, Leo seemed to suggest that this came a little bit too late.
Well, I mean, to be fair, so to be unfair, well, one of the reasons she got the job is because of the botched attempt at a sale that was undertaken by Leo Apotheker and the prior management, where they said, look, we're just going to sell this thing. Any buyers out there? Raise your hand. Anyone? No one? Somebody? Anybody make a bid? That was not a successful sales process. But quietly, she's been trying to sell this division from what we understand. Also, gets some big acquisition targets, discussing things with EMC. A Bloomberg News reported a couple weeks ago that they were late into discussions with EMC about some sort of possible business combination. So she's been trying to do some sort of big change in the company. Of course, you know, I stood out here 10 years ago when Carly Fiorina was trying to do the very same thing in acquiring Compaq, doubling down in PCs, doubling down to the data center. So there have been a lot of attempts to revive this company, both by selling off big divisions, by doing big acquisitions. I mean, the acquisitions have been incredible. This company has spent tens of billions of dollars, even over the last 10 years, in doing acquisitions, and yet the top line has barely budged in spite of all those billions of dollars spent in acquisitions.
And Corey, I want to switch to another topic. I mean, I know you're HP headquarters, but let's talk a little bit about Marissa Mayer and Yahoo and this acquisition of Snapchat. You know, you heard Leo as well in the last hour accusing her of basically being a glorified venture capitalist, and she's not running this company properly. Is that fair?
Well, I think, look, acquisitions are ways a lot of companies have grown successfully. And Hewlett-Packard, you know, you cannot overemphasize how important Hewlett-Packard is to the very fiber and nature of Silicon Valley. I mean, Hewlett-Packard were Stanford engineers who started their business in a garage right here in Palo Alto. Just a couple blocks over here, Jerry Yang and Dave Filo were Stanford engineers who started a search engine, an indexing engine for this new thing called the Internet, and started Yahoo. So these guys were really inspired. The Yahoo founders were inspired by the founders of Hewlett-Packard and hoped to follow in their footsteps. They have done lots of acquisitions and hoped they could grow their business in that manner. Yahoo has struggled mightily, has made some occasionally brilliant acquisitions. I mean, they made an investment in a little company called Google that seemed like a competitor, but they managed to botch that investment and that investment process into the Google IPO. Snapchat has got that kind of the kind of growth metrics that we've rarely seen in Silicon Valley, just like in terms of user engagement and activity without revenues, just like Google did once upon a time. I'm not for an instant saying that Snapchat will become Google, but it's a kind of exciting thing that has a lot of people interested, and you can see why Yahoo would want to attach themselves to that rising star.
And Corey, before we go, $10 billion, too much, too little, just right?
I mean, I wouldn't do it, but it's a company without any revenues. It seems ridiculous. But there's a level of engagement that one might think if you attached revenues to it, it might mean something. But you can't, I mean, you've just got to have a dream there. There's no, to me, a logical process that can get you to a $10 billion valuation on a company. Now, we don't know the terms of the deal. Sometimes at a very late stage deal like this, there can be resets where the late investors are guaranteed that any future round that they will not be crammed down in terms of their percentage of the company that they're acquiring, unlike the earlier investors. We don't know if that's the case,
okay.
But that's a hefty valuation on a business model that doesn't really exist yet.